Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Battle for Hjalgar by Torsten Weitze, translated by Tim Casey, narrated by Gildart Jackson. Chapter 1. Ahren looked anxiously at the turbulent waters beyond the railing of the Queen of the Waves. The flagship sliced her course with fierce power through the agitated sea, and every time her wooden frame broke through the crest of a wave, the vessel shuddered with a deafening creak. Each conquered swell brought them closer to the coast of King's Island, their goal for several weeks now, and to where they had been heading under full sail. Ahren could hardly wait to arrive. There were so many reasons that he wanted to flee from this ship that it made his head spin just thinking about them. And he simply couldn't stop worrying during these final days on board. Something had happened to the Pall Pillar, something terrible. The magical dungeon containing the dark god, He Who Forces, had been a guarantee for peace in Jorath for centuries. A peace now shattered by petty animosities involving various kingdoms, not to mention the occasional attacks of scattered dark ones. To top it all, control of the Pall Pillar had been wrenched from the ancients. Neither Uldini nor any of the other ageless wizards could sense any sign of the charm they had woven to protect Jorath all those years before. The fear that the adversary might already be free lay like a cerecloth over everyone on board.
"Speak for yourself,"
said Cullen casually as he chewed on a large bone. "It would take a lot to frighten me." Ahren looked at his friend in annoyance.
"Why does all this uncertainty have no effect on you?" he asked the enormous wolf, whose white fur was shimmering in the mist.
The weather was just as dreary as Aaron's thoughts. It was only now he noticed that it was drizzling. He wiped his face and listened to Cullen's practical response.
"There's nothing we can do for the moment. Any plans we make now will be useless because we don't have detailed information."
His mighty jaws snapped the bone he was chewing as he looked over at Ahren with his yellow wolf eyes.
"But you know that already. We've told everyone exactly that at least 3 times.
"Not everyone," whispered Ahren, before groaning and looking back at the poop of the ship.
"Oh, Ahren," said Cullen.
And now the young forest guardian could feel the despondency in the wolf's thoughts too.
"You have to give her time."
A solitary figure was standing at the rear of the ship, gracefully fighting several imaginary enemies with her 2 drawn swords. Her silky black hair was tied up in a knot and held by a traditional hairpin, which identified her as a warrior from the Eternal Empire. Ahren could have described every detail of her fine features, for Kara had been a constant companion in his thoughts and in his heart for some time now. It was only the cold, absent expression on her face, which she had been presenting to all on the vessel for weeks now, that he would much rather forget. Kara had withdrawn into the void, that meditative state in which one feels no emotions, as an antidote to a magical curse she had endured. What had been intended as a useful skill in a crisis situation was now revealing itself to be an invisible prison. The warrior was trapped in the void, unable or unwilling to escape, and consequently she was as cold as ice towards all other living creatures. It wasn't that she had been hurtful or hostile. She still knew her friends from her enemies, but all her actions now betrayed an unfeeling sobriety which was quite hard to bear, especially if you were her partner.
"If we're a couple at all anymore," thought Ahren bitterly.
"Would you stop yourself pitying?" growled Cullen. "Learn from her example and do a bit of training instead. That will distract you."
Ahren nodded weakly. He was in top-notch condition, for he had indeed been doing little else than improving his physical skills in an effort to overcome his worries and fears, and it also gave him a chance to think. He had come up with a space-saving training regime which he rigorously implemented within the narrow confines of the ship. Yet he yearned for a run in the forest, with Cullen by his side, the trees rustling above and around them, and the gentle contact with the undergrowth which would caress man and wolf, skillfully weaving their way through it. If Ahren was honest with himself, all he wanted to do was to get away from this ship, away from his doubts and fears, away from the pitiful looks of the crew, away from Kara. He shuddered at the thought of it, and Cullen stood up to press his head in close to his master.
"I understand you," said the wolf, to Aaron's surprise. "During a fight, there are only two options, fight or flight. You can't fight Kara in her present condition, and so you want to escape."
Ahren couldn't help but smile. Cullen's psyche was still that of a wolf, but he was much too clever than was good for such a vain animal. He always came up with the simplest pearls of wisdom in tricky situations, and the young paladin was certain that his four-legged friend's voice, which he could hear in his own head, had saved him from making a fool of himself on more than one occasion.
"You're not going to make an idiot of yourself again now, are you?"
teased Cullen, jostling up against Ahren playfully.
"I really couldn't bear it."
Ahren tousled the top of the animal's head, which led to a contented growl. "Here's a suggestion," said the young man. "I'll wear myself out to the point of not being able to lift my arms, and then we'll go and ask the others if there's any news." Cullen sat back on his hind legs. His mouth was open and he was panting with his wolf smile.
"I'm sure Aldini will be delighted when you ask him the same question for the fourth time today."
The sun was already touching the horizon behind the thick blanket of cloud when Ahren, soaked through with rain and sweat, went below deck to put on fresh clothes and to see how his friends were getting on. Their communal cabin was sticky and overfull. Four figures were huddled around the solitary table, their heads leaning inward in a conspiratorial manner. They looked up as he and Cullen entered, and Ahren couldn't help but smile at the motley group before him. There was Fulk, of course, his erstwhile master and mentor, whose weather-beaten face looked as serious as ever beneath his closely cropped grey hair. In glowing counterpoint, beside him, the red-headed elf Jelmin Nolan beamed at Ahren, her bluish-green dress shimmering in the dim cabin light. Uldini, in the figure of a dark-skinned boy of 9 summers or so, was scowling. The arch-wizard was doubtless anticipating yet another request for news from Ahren. Fisker, the ever-young paladin with locks of blonde hair, whom they had only recently freed from the throes of a dramatic love-hate relationship, cheerfully raised his half-empty goblet of wine in honour of the new arrivals. "How lovely to see you, Ahren," he said with a twinkle. "You're keeping yourself to yourself, an awful lot." The young forest guardian nodded, pulled off his wet jerkin and fumbled in his knapsack for a new one, before finally responding, "I'm not exactly good company at the moment."
"True enough," said Aldini bitingly, "and it's only taken several weeks for you to notice that."
Ahren pulled the fresh jerkin over his head and took off his trousers. "Any news?" he asked, partly out of curiosity and partly to annoy Aldini.
"Sleeps in treetop, has made contact," said Fulk, cutting Aldini off before the arch-wizard had a chance to make a sarcastic remark. Ahren stopped in mid-movement.
"And?" he asked excitedly.
What did she say?
Jelni Nolan giggled and looked at him in mock disapproval.
One thing at a time, my dear. First the trousers, then the news. You may well be quite a handsome-looking fellow now, but there is only so long I want to see you in your underwear.
Ahren grinned. The priestess had a subtle humour that she revealed at unexpected moments. He quickly finished dressing, then sat down at the free place that Falk and Fisker had indicated to him after pushing themselves to either side.
In her uniquely cryptic style, Sleeps in Treetop has given us to understand that she has arrived on King's Island, said Aldini. She travelled along the borderlands and has reported that the Pall Pillar still exists, although in a different form. I wish she would be clearer when it comes to transmitting important information like this.
It felt to Ahren as if the steel hoops that he had imagined constricting his chest had suddenly sprung open, allowing him to breathe easier again at last. Aldini raised a warning finger.
Now comes the bad news. It has expanded and is now covering a third of the borderlands.
Ahren was confused momentarily, but the grim faces on the faces of his companions made it abundantly clear to him that this news proved that the situation was far worse than he had anticipated.
Nobody has lived there for ages. Why does that matter? As long as the adversary remains trapped in the Pall Pillar, we still have enough time to find the other paladins.
Perhaps, murmured Falk. The fact is that the Pall Pillar is no longer under the control of the ancients. Our enemy has captured his own prison for himself.
Jelni Nolan nodded slowly, her beautiful face now a picture of uncertainty.
Which means that he doesn't want to come out of the Pall Pillar for the time being. And that worries me the most.
We all feel the same, added Aldini darkly.
Did Sleeps in Treetop say anything else? Asked Ahren, taking Fisker's goblet. The young forest guardian hadn't consumed alcohol for weeks, but now he was in urgent need of a sup to calm his nerves.
Aldini shook his head.
The imperative that we ancients only communicate with each other using intricate secret magic is truer now than it has ever been before. If he who forces really is sufficiently awake to have seized control of the Pall Pillar, then it is absolutely essential that he doesn't succeed in eavesdropping on our communications and thereby gain an advantage.
The archwizard rubbed his bald pate in frustration.
Consequently, every charmed sentence we utter from now on is going to exhaust us, and the greater the distance between us, the greater the exhaustion.
He sighed regretfully.
My magical warning cry when the Pall Pillar slipped from our control was a mistake. Now the enemy knows that we are preparing to meet in conclave for the first time in centuries on King's Island.
What were you discussing as I came in?
Asked Ahren after a time, breaking the gloomy stillness that had settled on the company following Aldini's words.
We were trying to figure out what the adversary's exact plan might be, said Fisker, looking longingly at the goblet in Aaron's hand.
Ahren placed the vessel deliberately down on the floor beside Falk, beyond Fisker's reach. The slim paladin had developed a considerable weakness for wine and other alcoholic beverages during his time as pirate captain, and even though Ahren had gradually weaned him off the demon drink since then, he didn't want Fisker to suffer a relapse.
What conclusion did you reach?
Asked Ahren, ignoring the furious look from his friend with the blonde curly hair.
That we are still in ignorance, growled Falk. Is it a ruse or a delaying tactic, perhaps? Is the Dark God still too weak to break out, or is he gathering his strength so that he can raise hell the instant he comes out? Is he preparing a powerful spell from within? These are all possibilities. The one thing that we can be certain of is that the Pall Pillar is as much a fortress as it is a prison. He isn't coming out, and we cannot get in.
Irritated, Ahren took a sip of wine. Why didn't you call me in earlier? He asked sulkily.
How good are you at magic theory? Retorted Aldini scornfully. Anyway, you are of no help in your present situation, so why don't you just lie down until we can provide you with answers instead of peppering us with questions?
The old Ahren would have been offended, but the past few years, and especially the moons on the Cutlass Sea, had toughened him up. Point for you, he murmured before stretching with a yawn. At least the Pall Pillar is still standing, and as long as it surrounds the adversary, that gives us time to prepare. Aldini waved his hand dismissively, and Ahren turned and went to his hammock. He climbed into it and tried to fall asleep, despite his uneasy thoughts concerning their future. Ahren woke in the middle of the night. A deep uneasiness flowed like a wave through his body, forcing him to get up. The cabin was enveloped in darkness, and his friends were lying peacefully asleep. Only a tiny nightlight flickered, causing Aaron's consciousness to take in a sea of shadows. Without thinking about it, he took a few steps until he was standing in front of Kara's peaceful face, which betrayed no hint of unease as she slept. There was no sign of the coldness on her visage, and Ahren had to stop himself from shouting his delight and planting a kiss on her lips. He had made that mistake twice already, fully convinced that the young woman had freed herself at last from the mental chains that had been shackling her. The first time, Jelnanolan had patched him up afterwards, for he had no sooner touched Kara than she had broken his finger. The second time, the young swordswoman had just about held back, but the disinterested look she had given him had been worse than any physical pain. He turned away from her and left the cabin. Where he wanted to go, he wasn't exactly sure. Perhaps on deck to visit Cullen, who would be lying at the prow, or to the solitariness of the crow's nest. If he couldn't sleep, he could just as well relieve the night watch. He was already at the foot of the steps which led up into the cool night air, when he heard a rumbling singing coming through the chinks of a closed door. Ahren knew immediately who it was. The voice was wafting from the room where Trogodon, the dwarf, had set up his little workshop. This was where the warrior tinkered at half a dozen projects simultaneously and followed his true vocation of creating things. Ahren quietly opened the door and saw the squat figure of his fun-loving friend sitting cross-legged on the floor with his back against the workbench, the calloused fingers of his right hand holding a small file with which he was working a delicate metal object in his left hand. Ahren stopped in surprise as he saw a scantily dressed sailor girl lying asleep, her head on Trogodon's lap. Trogodon's stone-grey hair was dishevelled and, Ahren had seen enough, he was just about to close the door again when the dwarf spoke.
She insisted on trying out dwarfish schnapps, murmured Trogodon, who had stopped singing and working as soon as he had spotted Ahren.
He waved the forest guardian in, who closed the door behind him. The dwarf rearranged the sailor's clothing so that she would stay warm and also to hide any unbecoming nakedness from the visitor as she slept. He patted the floor beside him with his large right hand.
Sit down beside me, Ahren. The schnapps knocked her out before things got interesting, and I'm not able to get to sleep. I'm just filing a parting gift for our dashing captain.
The warrior lifted up a beautifully engraved captain's whistle.
This can be heard from anywhere on the ship. It means he won't have to roar his head off every time he issues a command.
Ahren grinned. Captain Auburn was correctness personified, someone who really believed in the chain of command, which meant that he spent a lot of his time issuing orders.
"He's going to love your present," said Ahren in a low voice. "I'm not so sure about the crew, though."
Trogodon laughed his deep, friendly laugh, which always reminded Ahren of smooth pebbles rattling along a tunnel. "Which is why I am going to give it to him only when we leave the ship."
He looked down mischievously at the sleeping sailor girl.
"I have too many friendships on board that I don't want to destroy before it's necessary."
Ahren raised an eyebrow as he looked at the woman. "Another redhead. I'm beginning to see a pattern. You didn't used to be so choosy."
Trogodon gave a dismissive wave. "Pure coincidence," he mumbled. But Ahren saw a sparkle in the warrior's eyes, which suggested he was hiding something. "What do you think of Sleeps in Treetops' little revelation? Has it reassured you at all?"
"When I heard it first, yes," said Ahren hesitantly, only to tap his forehead a moment later. "But my understanding has led me to a different opinion. Otherwise I wouldn't be sitting here beside a dwarf and his intoxicated companion in the middle of the night."
"Good point," said Trogodon with a laugh. "Just as well we'll be landing on King's Island in a few days. Otherwise you'd bore a hole through the deck with all your restless energy and nervous walking about."
Ahren couldn't think of a snappy riposte.
"You mean we're nearly there?"
he asked hopefully. The inclement weather and the unfavourable winds had delayed things to the point where Ahren had no idea any more if the ship was making headway.
Trogodon nodded and planted his large hand on Aaron's shoulder. "Uldini didn't tell you, probably because you would have become completely unbearable."
The warm, sympathetic undertone in the dwarf's voice belied the hardness of his analysis.
"I just have to get off this ship and do something," said Ahren forcefully. "I swear by the three I'll go mad otherwise."
Trogodon's laughter rumbled again.
"The other paladins are in pretty wretched shape too. Another crazy one won't make much of a difference."
Ahren scowled. He and his friends had been wandering Jorath for years, trying to find the rest of the paladins so that they could encourage them to don their old mantles and become champions of the gods once again. Unfortunately, this undertaking was proving more complicated than originally anticipated. Almost every paladin they had come across had been either in an awkward predicament or in a mental state that one would never associate with a heroic figure. In extreme cases, the paladins had been afflicted by both conditions. Fisker and Aluna, the two paladins they had found most recently, had been busy playing the parts of mutually hostile pirate captains with extraordinary venom, trying to make each other's existence hell by engaging their fleets in constant skirmishes, with Fisker's soul animal, Kosobo, even having been tortured and crippled, while the giant snake, Fjolmungar, had, thanks to wayward blood magic, taken control of Aluna. Ahren sighed and pinched his nose in an effort to come back to the here and now.
"Just once it would be lovely for a paladin to turn up of their own free will, no strings attached, just because he or she wants to help us. Is that too much to ask?"
Trogodon made a rumbling sound, his hand still planted on Aaron's shoulder. Then he became serious. "How are you getting on with Kara?" asked the dwarf, having pinpointed the true cause of Aaron's problems.
"I'm not." Ahren shrugged his shoulders, shaking off Trogodon's hand without meaning to. "I'm trying to keep away from her as much as possible. Anything else is too painful, emotionally and physically." He gave Trogodon an agonized sideways look. "Did you hear that she almost sliced me up from the belly button to the jaws a couple of weeks ago during training?" Trogodon nodded but said nothing. Ahren continued bitterly.
"Afterwards, the only thing she said, in a matter-of-fact voice, was that I needed to be more aware of dangers. Just like that, no emotion whatsoever. He shivered.
Perhaps your solution is the best, mused Trogodon. Jelny Nolan is working intensively on drawing our old Kara back to us. She is certain to succeed sooner or later. Or maybe Aluna can help once she and Fajol Mongar are back from their detour in the Cutlass Sea. She has plenty of experience of long-lasting, mind-altering conditions.
Ahren huffed in frustration and stared down at the floor. At that, the dwarf reached one of his short arms up to the workbench behind him and pulled down a small metal bottle.
Here, lad, take a sip. Only time can put your problems to right, but this will help you sleep, at least.
Lost in thought, Ahren took the bottle and removed the cork. Before the sharp aromas emanating from the bottle had a chance to warn him, he had already placed his lips to the neck, tilted his head back, and was downing the liquid gulp by gulp.
"Oh, dear,"
he heard Trogodon say. Then Ahren crashed, head first, to the deck, and was out for the count. Ahren woke up with a jolt. He felt a dreadful pain in his ear. Something was attacking him. With flailing arms, he was up in a flash, drawing his dagger before his eyes had even fully opened. "I've been kidnapped," shot through his head. Only a few minutes ago, he had been sitting beside Trogodon, and they had been drinking together.
"Well, at least his reflexes are functioning," said Falk behind him.
Ahren finally managed to orientate himself and lowered his weapon. He was on the deck of the Queen of the Waves, and the morning sun was already beaming down. Then he did a double take and realized that the burning orb was already on the other side of the sky. "It's evening," said Ahren, taken aback and looking around in a circle. "How long have I been sleeping?"
Trogodon, Falk, and Jelny Nolan were standing around a coil of rope upon which the young man had presumably been sleeping, grinning broadly.
"Only the whole livelong day," said Falk sarcastically, holding a little metal bottle in his hand. "You were a splendid example to the entire crew performing your snoring concert while they went about their honest day's work."
His erstwhile master's sharp tone could have cut through rock, causing Ahren to flinch involuntarily. "That was my fault," said Jelny Nolan, beaming. "When you didn't wake up, I told Trogodon that sunlight would help to bring you back to your senses, and I suggested bringing you up here on deck."
The dwarf nodded.
"But it seems you needed a few more hours than we had thought. No wonder, considering the amount of dwarfish schnapps you downed."
"It was stronger than I had anticipated," said Ahren lamely.
"Of course,"
grumbled Trogodon, taking the bottle from Falk.
"That was the good stuff. My favorite brew when times are hard."
He tipped the bottle deliberately over to show that every last drop had been drained. "Even I only take the tiniest nip. Falk almost had to rip your ears off there to get you to wake up."
Ahren was only too glad that dwarfish schnapps didn't result in a hangover. Otherwise, he would almost certainly have spent the next week in his hammock, a whimpering picture of misery. He nodded at Trogodon apologetically and rubbed his sore ear. The crew working around him smirked, but Ahren realized it was good-natured mockery that they were aiming at him. The 13th Paladin had achieved such a hero status in their eyes, following all the dangers they had endured and survived together, that Ahren could swing across the rigging naked, warbling an elfish ballad without affecting their admiration for him.
"Please don't try that,"
said Cullen dryly, looking critically over his shoulder at his friend from his place at the prow.
"I'm not sure I could take you seriously ever again."
"Don't worry, big lad," responded Ahren with a grin. His senses were all slowly returning to normal, and for good measure, he had a good stretch to help him limber up. Then he turned to his friends. "Where are the others?" Jelnanolan pointed down into the belly of the ship. "They're holding another council of war." The elf frowned. "It's not very productive. In fact, I'd almost go so far as to say that you made better use of your time than us." Trogodon's eyes suddenly sparkled.
"It would be an honor for me to offer you a little of the dwarfish schnapps, honored priestess. The time would pass by more quickly, and..." he began eagerly, but Jelminolan gave him a dismissive wave.
"Oh, no," she said with a laugh. "Legend has it that elves are known to have melted away after drinking it. I had rather not take the risk."
Ahren was only half listening to his friend's banter. He had caught sight of Kara, who was training alone and determinedly on the poop. Any laughter without her participation seemed an act of betrayal, and the dark cloud of frustration settled on his thoughts again.
"Land ahoy!" shouted a voice from the crow's nest, and with a yelp of relief, Ahren ran to the railing and stared in the direction that the lookout was pointing. Half the crew, as well as his friends, followed suit. In the late evening light of the setting sun, they could make out a faint shadow on the horizon, which was nothing more than a diffuse shape. Nevertheless, the sailors slapped each other on the back, and the mood was suddenly boisterous. The mariners, too, had heard the rumors concerning the Pall Pillar, the particularly dark sailor's yarn that had woven its way from one crew member to the next, concerned the magical blast that had afflicted the ship weeks previously, and which, also the yarn suggested, was proof that Jorath had fallen. When Ahren looked at the beaming faces of some of the crew, he was sure that they were relieved to see that there was indeed a coast to which they could return. The paladin jutted out his chin determinedly, and then sensed Cullen's solemn message of support.
"Not as long as I have a breath in my body will Jorath fall."
Ahren stayed standing at the railing until deep into the night, watching the lights on the coastline as they grew bigger. Following his inordinately long slumber, a normal night's sleep was out of the question, and after some time he was joined by Sergeant Yantilla, who looked out into the darkness peppered by lights and gave a deep sigh.
"Tomorrow we will be standing on solid ground again at last. Even if we are heading into war, at least it will be fought out on terra firma. If I had known in the forest that time what we were letting ourselves in for when we decided to place ourselves under your command, then I would have led my men and women into the deepest part of the undergrowth where we would have lain low for years. With all due respect, of course, Squire."
Ahren glanced sideways at the haggard woman. "If I had known what was going to come our way, I would have kept you company," he responded humorously. The soldier beside him, an erstwhile mercenary and highway robber, had ambushed Ahren and his companions on their first meeting. Following a flash of inspiration and his own deep-rooted inclination to avoid as much bloodshed as possible, Ahren had turned the tables on her by revealing himself to be a paladin and offering them employment. The loyalty she had shown him since then was genuine, to the point that she and her subordinates had stood faithfully by him during their hair-raising adventures on the Cutlass Sea. "But why are you speaking of war, Sergeant?" he inquired. "As far as we know, the charm pillar is still standing." Yantilla pointed out into the darkness. "Do you see that small flickering red point yonder?" Ahren squinted and looked in the direction indicated.
A tiny red light did indeed seem to be glimmering in the distance.
I do, he said casually. Is it another ship?
Yantilla shook her head.
That is the beacon of King's Island.
She paused for a moment.
In times of war, they pour a special powder into it so that it shines red.
For a while, the only things that could be heard were the creaking of the timbers and the waves breaking against the ship's keel.
Damn, said Ahren finally, scratching his beard.
I couldn't have put it better myself, responded Yantilla with a grim look.
At least this cursed uncertainty will be over tomorrow, said Ahren, searching for a silver lining.
Let's only hope that we won't be wishing we were back in those halcyon days before the cutlass sea turned nasty on us, said the haggard soldier darkly.
Are you still flirting with a return to the deep forest, Sergeant?
Jested Ahren, trying to drive away the fatalistic mood.
We shall see, Squire, was the woman's response. We shall see.
Then she nodded, turned away, and entered Captain Auburn's cabin. Ahren continued to look at the coast with its small, weak light, that red glimmer in the darkness, which seemed to be igniting a real war.
Ahren woke up at the ship's prow with a furry pillow under his head. He had snuggled up to the wolf deep into the night and dropped off to sleep there. Cullen was snoring lightly, his muzzle buried beneath his tail. Ahren tickled the ears of the animal, which began to twitch until his friend finally opened his eyes to look at Ahren affectionately.
You're always welcome to wake me up like that, said Cullen, yawning.
Ahren was immediately enveloped in an overpowering stench streaming out of the wolf's seemingly insatiable mouth. He pushed himself violently away from the animal and gasped for fresh air.
I'm going to ask Jelni Nolan to spray your mouth in a magic scent, he said teasingly.
Then you will smell of violets, and no dark one will take you seriously again.
Cullen finished his yawning by closing his powerful jaws together loudly.
Everyone will take me seriously after the first bite, he thought nonchalantly.
Ahren looked over the bulwark. King's Island was clearly visible now. The flat, densely built-up rock with its sprawling harbour on the seafront was the capital city of the Night Marshes and accommodated not only the royal palace, but also the wealthiest merchants in the northeastern part of Jorath. Ahren had never seen so much pomp and wealth as he had on King's Island, and it seemed unreal to him that he was returning to this place resplendent with power and gold. When he had set sail from here on his voyage to the Silver Cliff, he had still been a green apprentice, likely as not to put his foot in it and do the wrong thing. He had, for example, wanted to save Kara from a gang of cutthroats in the city they were now approaching, yet... Ahren closed his eyes to block out the memory. But it came nonetheless. In the end, it had been she who had rescued him, as he was being attacked by the very same assailants who had only a moment before been threatening the girl. It all seemed so long ago. A slight cough caused him to turn around, where he saw a young sailor looking at him shyly.
Lady Jelna Nolan wishes to speak to you, Squire. She was very insistent that you go to her.
Ahren raised his eyebrows in surprise and looked quizzically at Cullen.
What are you looking at me for? I'm only after waking up myself, said the wolf, sniffing at the sailor. The lad doesn't even have a treat for me, he added sulkily.
Ahren looked at the sailor. I will go to her immediately. In the meanwhile, fetch some food for Cullen, soldier. If he's hungry, he can be quite demanding.
Cullen snapped playfully at the young man who fled below deck, roaring at his mates to get food for the wolf.
That was fun,
said the animal. "Don't overdo it," warned Ahren with a grin. "You don't want to lose your status as ship's mascot, do you?" Then he quickly went below deck to seek out the elf. A hungry Cullen might be dangerous, but an angry Jelninolan was a force of nature. The communal cabin looked like a battlefield, with Jelninolan as the undisputed general, center stage. Items of clothing were strewn around the room. Falk, Fisker, and Trogodon were sitting around the priestess. They were polishing, patching, and cleaning their armor under the watchful eye of the elf, who brought her companions to task for the least evidence of carelessness by clicking her fingers or raising an eyebrow. Aldini was sitting in one corner of the room, robed in his black garment with its golden hem, which he wore on official occasions. His bald head was freshly polished, and he seemed to be royally amused by the other three, who were arduously carrying out Jelninolan's commands. "What's going on here?" asked Ahren in wonderment.
"We shall be docking in King's Island Harbour in the next few hours," said Jelninolan severely. "The harbour watch have doubtless noticed our approach by now. This means that we will be welcomed with full military honours. After all, this ship is carrying 3 paladins and 2 ancients, all invited to the first conclave, to be called in centuries. We must not appear as a gang of decrepit ruffians." The last words were directed at Falk, who lowered his head in embarrassment and continued to concentrate on polishing his armor. Ahren grinned. He only wished he had been there for the battle of words, which Falk and Trogodon had clearly lost. "That's a good idea," he said in an exaggeratedly respectful voice, before sitting down obediently and setting about to bring his armor in good order. "Traitor," growled Falk in a low voice, glaring at his erstwhile student, who winked back at him mischievously. "My master taught me to avoid battles that I have no hope of winning," he said innocently. "Or was that bad advice?" Instead of answering, Falk polished his breastplate angrily. The rest of the morning passed by in an atmosphere of eager busyness, every inch of their appearance being assiduously perfected. Jelninolan prepared for her imminent disembarkation with a meticulousness that Ahren soon considered to be over the top. Just as he was about to voice his doubts on the matter, Aldini spoke.
"Remember that every man, woman, and child on King's Island is going to be watching you. This will be a moment of historic importance, which the bards will sing of for many moons to come. The better you all look, the higher the morale among the populace. The war fire is burning in the beacon for good reason. Therefore, give these people the heroes they deserve. It may well be the last pleasant memory they shall have for a considerable time to come."
Following the Archwizard's little speech, Ahren simply closed his mouth again and concentrated conscientiously on following Jelninolan's instructions. After what seemed like an eternity, the moment had arrived. Ahren stood, freshly coiffured, dressed and armoured, beside Falk and the others, while Jelninolan inspected them with a military eye. Finally, she nodded her approval and gestured to the cabin door.
"Right then, out with you onto the deck. No dice, no wine, no food. I don't want you to be seen gambling or splattering food on yourselves. Send Kara in to me so that the two of us can prepare."
"Will Kara play along?" chuckled Fisker, only to fall silent under Jelninolan's withering stare.
"The poor thing has lost the key to her emotions. That does not mean that she is stupid," said the elf coldly. "I am sure she will understand my reasoning more quickly than some of the imbeciles in this cabin."
The well-accoutred men then sheepishly left the room, Falk gesturing to Ahren to send Kara down.
The young man gulped, then steeled himself. Kara was doing her relentless training on the poop. Only Jelna Nolan had been speaking regularly to the young woman in an attempt to draw her out of her emotional trance. Everyone else on board had thought it best to steer clear of her.
Kara, Jelna Nolan wishes to see you, said Ahren in a formal voice.
He had hoped to sound more gentle, but he had failed, thanks to the distant stare she had given him.
You look good, she said in a neutral voice. Very impressive.
Thank you, he said in surprise, stepping towards her instinctively.
You look really good, too.
I doubt it, she responded, slipping past him.
I will go and prepare myself, too.
No sideways glance, no fleeting touch. They might just as well have been two acquaintances who happened to be on board the same ship. Ahren clenched his fists and was on the point of screaming. Only the admiring looks from the crew, who were staring at him in wonderment, held him back. These men and women had battled and shed blood for Aaron's sake and for the sake of his cause. Some of their comrades had even lost their lives. They deserved to see him as the hero they imagined him to be. He joined the others on the main deck, and Falk nodded his approval. If I'm reading the reactions of the crew correctly, then we are in for a good reception, said Fisker jovially.
Don't forget, warned Falk, you are a paladin once more, Fisker. Nobody here wants to see a drunken pirate captain.
The reaction to Falk's admonition came in the form of chattering in the rigging. Kasobo, Fisker's sole animal, was hanging from the ropes above, baring his teeth and mocking his friend. The little monkey had a mischievous streak that belied his sharp mind.
"Stop laughing and come down," said the blonde paladin, unperturbed. "It's time we spruced you up, too."
The little monkey immediately did as he was told, whereupon Ahren slapped his forehead.
"What's wrong, boy?" asked Falk in a worried voice.
I'd better do the same with Cullen. If he disembarks ungroomed, I'll never hear the end of it.
Chapter 2 It was early afternoon as the Queen of the Waves glided gracefully under a clear blue sky into the harbour of King's Island. Whatever it was that Ahren had expected, nothing prepared him for the sight that awaited them. Cheering citizens, closely packed together, were throwing flowers into the water. Proud military heralds blasted their bugles, and Ahren calculated that there had to be 100 knights in arms forming a guard of honor on the main pier to welcome the new arrivals. The nearer they approached, the more details Ahren could make out, and the more nervous he became.
Imagine the look on their faces if Captain Auburn ordered his crew to dock at the wrong pier, whispered Trogodon to Ahren with a wink.
The corner of Aaron's mouth twitched as he pictured the scene. The entire guard of honor and the welcoming canopy under which he had spotted King Senior's blue ground hurriedly repositioning itself so that they could be in their new place before the ship docked. Tempting, he murmured back.
But we'd better wait until the war has been won for pranks like that.
It would be better for Auburn's health, too, added Fisker. Our over-particular friend is about to burst with excitement. Ahren glanced over at the prim and proper captain, standing at the wheel and appearing to be a good hand taller than normal in all his regalia. This could well be the crowning pinnacle of his glittering career, Ahren thought, and to spoil it for him would simply be too cruel. Then he looked at the cheering crowds, and when he made out the individual faces and saw the hope in their eyes, he flinched inwardly.
"Now do you understand?"
whispered Jelna Nolan gently in his ear. "We are the personification of hope for these people. We embody everything they could wish for in their desire for salvation. Courage, honor, virtue." Her speech was interrupted
by a quiet burp from Trogodon, which caused her to look daggers at him with her hard green eyes.
"It just had to get out," said the dwarf meekly, "and I thought better now than when we're standing before the king."
The Queen of the Waves slipped easily alongside the pier, slowing all the time. Meanwhile, Ahren had another look at the monarch under the deep blue pavilion with the royal coat of arms emblazoned on it. The man seemed considerably older than the last time the young forest guardian had seen him, older than the 2 years could account for.
"The monarch must have endured hard times in the meantime," said Falk sympathetically. "I hate seeing people age like that."
For the first time, Ahren felt a sense of what it was his companions had endured throughout their long lives, watching friends and acquaintances become old and die, with time having no effect on the paladins themselves, however. While the crew were tying up the ship, the cheering from the crowd swelled to a deafening crescendo. The surrounding piers and streets were teeming with people, and Ahren was surprised that no one had fallen into the water.
"As if anyone would notice," interjected Cullen dryly. "But I have to admit, I could get used to receptions like this."
Ahren rolled his eyes as he sensed the wolf's self-satisfied enjoyment of the admiring crowds. When the gangplank was finally lowered onto the pier, a royal herald boarded the ship and took up position beside the wooden walkway before unfurling a scroll. Aldini floated up to the elderly man and began speaking urgently to him, pointing at items that were written on the parchment and gesticulating wildly.
"What's he doing there?"
whispered Ahren out of the corner of his mouth, all the while waving politely to the crowds and smiling. Fisker sniggered surreptitiously. "No doubt he is bringing the good man up to speed on the latest developments, making sure that no heroic deed or title will be omitted during the proclamation. Aldini is going to milk this event for all it's worth, believe you me. After a few days, half of the nobility and merchants will be asking themselves how they could possibly have donated so much of their fortunes to the war effort and allowed themselves to be so easily blinded by our cunning ancients' dazzling performance." Ahren understood. Aldini was a political intriguer of the first order. The cheering dignitaries surrounding them were rich pickings for the nefarious arch-wizard. The herald waved his arm and called out loudly,
"Hear ye, hear ye! I present Baron Dorian Falkenstein, Paladin of the Gods, Hero of the Dark Days, General of the Northeastern Allied Cavalry, Conqueror of Delsaurus, Thousand Tooth, and of the Low Worm Jagged Scale."
Ahren swore he could feel the roars shaking his very marrow while one and all on the harbour and the surrounding streets roared at the top of their voices as if there were no tomorrow. He knew that those in the night marshes loved their paladin above anyone, even though they only knew him from the centuries-old stories. Yet as Falk strode down the gangplank, grasping the hilt of his broadsword that was hanging from his belt with one hand, his other hand holding the mighty dwarfish shield made from deep steel, he really did look every inch the mythical figure of folklore, which indeed he was. Jelninolan had also slipped him a dark blue cape that billowed majestically in the wind, and at that moment Ahren felt a little sorry for Senius Blueground. There was no way that the monarch could compete with the paladin striding towards him, and the poor man could only hope that he wouldn't be completely overshadowed by Falk's towering presence. "By the time we're all standing beside him, the king will have become completely anonymous," was the thought that flashed through Aaron's mind. There was something unreal about the whole thing. Then it was Jelninolan's turn. She walked forward in the blue-green robe she reserved for such occasions.
She had tied her hair up into an elegant tower shape, and she was holding her storm fiddle in the crook of her left arm. The fanfare sounded again, and once again a silence descended on the harbour.
"Hear ye, hear ye! The priestess Jelninolan from far distant Ithinian, member of the ancients, and awakener of storm weaving!"
There was a sharp intake of breath from Fisker, who was standing beside Ahren. "Aldini has really overdone it with his bravado," he hissed, pointing at a small delegation of elves who were staring fixedly at Jelninolan. The elf priestess walked in a dignified manner down to the pier, with the thundering applause of the spectators welcoming her, but Ahren could see the tension in the priestess's shoulders. Storm weaving had been forbidden in Ithinian ever since the schism among the elves, and it would have been better for her people to have learned that Jelninolan had resuscitated this ancient form of magic in a more tactful manner than through a human herald. Aldini, too, seemed to have noticed his error, for he gave Jelninolan an apologetic look, which she ignored.
"Can't wait to see how the arch-wizard straightens that out," said Trogodon with a smirk, as the herald signalled to the dwarf to come forward. With his enormous hammer casually slung over his shoulder and wearing his knee-length chainmail, Trogodon stood on the deck, gesturing to the onlookers to clap as the fanfare blared out. His stone-grey hair and his mighty beard were plaited into elaborate knots, and if it weren't for the fact that he was grinning like a mischievous rascal, the warrior would undoubtedly have looked suitably heroic.
"Hear ye, hear ye! Trogodon, from the Silver Cliff, bearer of a dwarfish ancestry name," announced the herald, as the crowd roared enthusiastically. With a rolling gait, Trogodon swaggered down the gangplank and along the pier as though he were waving a tankard of beer at a rowdy gang of admiring barroom brawlers, rather than acknowledging the entire population of King's Island.
"Can he never take things seriously?"
whined Aldini to the others.
"That's exactly what he is doing," countered Ahren. "Alcohol is no joke as far as he's concerned."
"That was a good one,"
said Cullen appreciatively, before giving a delighted bark. Aldini scowled at Ahren as he floated towards the gesturing herald. As usual, the arch-wizard hovered a pace above the ground, mystical winds causing his black robe to billow while tiny mysterious flashes of light sparked around him. Ahren had seen Aldini's posing too often by now to be impressed as the boyish figure began floating down the gangplank. The expectant silence of the crowd was punctuated by admiring oohs and ahs.
"Aldini Getobo, first among the ancients, weaver of the Pall spell, and beloved of the gods!"
While the onlookers gasped in admiration, Fisker sniggered. Amazing, he has claimed 3 titles, but only one of them has he earned on his own. The fact that the gods like him is thanks to them, not him, and all the ancients participated in the Pall spell. Ahren grinned. The cheap showmanship on official occasions suited his little wizard friend's personality to a T. Then it was Fisker's turn, with his silver shimmering cape made from deep silk and his elegantly combed blonde locks framing his mischievous face, which contained a smile so charming that Ahren was certain the paladin would receive more invitations to secret trysts than he could possibly honour during their stay.
"You've hit the nail on the head," commented Cullen dryly. "If he were a wolf, then any clever alpha worth his salt would keep him well away from the pack, especially from the she-wolves."
The herald gestured to Fisker.
"Fisker Milanius, Paladin of the gods, hero of the dark days, dagger ray slayer, protector of the eastern seas, admiral of the allied eastern navy.
Ahren raised his eyebrows in surprise as the crowd roared and some of the ladies swooned in rapture. He had only known Fisker as a swashbuckling pirate and as a somewhat disreputable paladin. It was true that he had learned from Fisker's own anecdotes that the ever-young paladin had achieved great things during the dark days before his moral collapse, but he was still taken aback by just how famous he had been. The blonde, locked man performed a cheeky pirouette on the pier while Kosobo did a somersault on his shoulder. The crowd hurrahed, and Aaron's moment of awe was over. The young forest guardian grinned and shook his head as the herald beckoned him to approach. At first, Ahren thought he would be nervous or restless, but in fact he was completely overwhelmed by the cheering people awaiting him. If it hadn't been his responsibility to give all the spectators hope in these dark times, then he would have simply marched right through them. Instead, he walked obediently up to the herald, who whispered in his ear, "It is an honor for me, squire." "And for me," murmured Ahren politely.
"It'll be my turn soon, won't it?" asked Cullen excitedly. "Check to see if he spelled my name correctly."
Ahren rolled his eyes and glanced quickly at the herald's scroll. "You're not there at all," he replied silently, while the fanfare resounded. "Presumably we go together."
He heard an angry growl behind him. "I refuse to disembark from this ship unless he announces my presence," said Cullen indignantly. "I am not a mere afterthought."
Then he gave Ahren clear instructions as to what the herald should say. The fanfares had ceased by now, and the crowd were waiting with bated breath for Aaron's introduction. But he was spitting out instructions in a low voice through gritted teeth to the bewildered herald, who was hurriedly taking notes, his hand shaking. The silence on the harbour was oppressive. Ahren hurriedly finished conveying Cullen's wishes, and finally normal protocols were resumed.
"Hear ye, hear ye! Squire Ahren, son of Edric, and saviour of King Senius Blueground, the 13th Paladin!"
There was genuine triumph in the final words of the herald, and the crowd exploded into cheers. Ahren tried to smile equably in all directions as he descended the gangplank. His broad shoulders were still constricted by the ribbon armour, which he had outgrown by now, and his long brown hair was tied in a knot at the back of his head. His short, full beard, with its reddish tinge, had just been trimmed, and his bow and wind blade rose prominently at his back. He was only too aware that he didn't look half as heroic as Falk, or anywhere near as charming as Fisker, but that didn't stop the crowd from cheering him to high heavens. Ahren strode past the knightly guard of honour, whose members looked at him in awe. He couldn't wait for this episode to be over. At last he arrived before King Senius Blueground, who gave him a formal handshake before bowing slightly, a gesture that Ahren reciprocated. The monarch didn't bother with words of greeting on account of the deafening roars, simply murmuring,
"We will talk later."
"Where's Cullen?" whispered Falk, his eyes narrowing suspiciously. "Wait and see," said Ahren, practically tasting the wolf's joyful anticipation on his tongue.
"Kara of the Eternal Empire, and companion to the 13th!
The herald's words resounded, and Ahren flinched as the young woman strolled down the gangplank and along the pier, coldly ignoring the crowds.
"What's the meaning of that last title?" asked Ahren, blushing a deep red.
"That was my idea," said Jelna Nolan, smiling sympathetically. That way the female half of the island will know what's what. We know what it really means. Fisker whispered to Trogodon, the pair grinning conspiratorially.
The two gentlemen are aware that they are here to participate in a conclave, are they not? My subjects are not your personal harem, said the king indignantly.
The two rakes immediately looked down sheepishly. Kara hadn't quite completed her walk along the pier when another fanfare split the sky.
Another one? Asked Aldini above the noise, but he's already announced all the dignitaries.
We're missing one, sighed Ahren.
Hear ye, hear ye. I present to you Cullen, sole animal to the 13th, chosen one of the goddess, rescuer of Tananton from the warden of the Weeping Valley, conqueror of the Fog Panther, kills in slumber, and guardian angel to the paladins.
On hearing those words, Cullen trotted proudly down the gangplank and sauntered onto the pier with his tongue lolling before stopping to enjoy the cheers of the crowd.
I don't believe it, groaned Aldini, while Falk glared at Ahren.
Guardian angel of the paladins, are you serious? He asked his erstwhile student in irritation.
You can all sort it out with him, said Ahren flippantly to his companions. You don't have to put up with the braggart in your heads all the time.
Secretly, he was enjoying Cullen's experience of his moment of glory.
Count yourself lucky that you already have your paladin nickname already, little brother, said Fisker, guffawing. Otherwise, we would be giving you a less pleasant one now.
Angel friend, suggested Trogodon.
Sole companion to the furry paladin, pondered Falk.
You are all aware that a war is currently breaking out, asked King Blueground, incredulous at the bantering going on around him.
Of course we know that, Your Majesty, said Falk, regaining his composure and bowing respectfully just as Cullen joined them, which is why we are enjoying every joke while we still can.
The king gestured to them to follow him, and together they turned away from the harbour and towards the 24 members of the nobility who were standing at a respectful distance, ready to escort them to the palace. The companions approached the open-doored carriages awaiting them, while the crowd at the harbour behind them cheered their every step. The friends exchanged knowing looks. The conclave was imminent, which meant only one thing. The dark days had returned. Ahren, Falk and Jelni Nolan climbed into one carriage, the others dividing up among the remaining vehicles. The young forest guardian was relieved not to be travelling with Kara, but this feeling pained him.
It's a pity that Selcina isn't experiencing this moment, sighed Falk, but she is still swimming as a narwhal in the bay.
Jelni Nolan hesitated for a heartbeat before jumping from the slowly moving carriage back down onto the street and walking back to one of the piers, causing the royal train to come to an abrupt halt.
"Stay sitting," she ordered firmly, just as Ahren and Falk were about to stand up. "I need as much space as I can on the pier."
She placed her storm fiddle on her shoulder and began to play an elaborate-sounding melody.
"Is she planning on metamorphosing Selcina here and now?" asked Ahren in amazement. "In front of everyone?"
Falk could barely hide his delight as he looked in fascination at the elf. "I think she wants to prove something at the same time," he said, and nodded surreptitiously to his left. Ahren looked in the direction indicated and spotted the four elves whom he had already seen from the ship. Their faces betrayed their undisguised disgust as they observed Jelni Nolan's magical fiddling.
The tones of the instrument were filling the whole of the harbour by now. The crowds were listening with bated breath, and the music was echoing off the quay walls so that it seemed as though more than one storm fiddle was being played. The echo harmonized effortlessly with the notes Jelna Nolan was playing, and Ahren heard Trogodon in the carriage behind, gasping in delight.
"Like the dwarfish tongue within the mines," he exclaimed delightedly, his eyes sparkling.
"That's going to annoy the elves even more," thought Ahren grimly.
"Let them think what they want," commented Cullen, who had sat down beside Aaron's carriage and was watching the spectacle. "Jelni Nolan doesn't need their approval any more."
As if to confirm Cullen's words, Jelna Nolan turned around in a circle as she played, and suddenly the aura of her true form could be felt with such force that Ahren gasped and flinched. An excited murmur rippled through the throngs of people, and hats were taken off in respectful admiration. Noble ladies curtsied on the spot, while seasoned knights sank down on one knee as Jelna Nolan walked past them, continuing to play. The melody grew more urgent and livelier, until finally a welcome image appeared in Aaron's mind. Ithinian, the mighty trees of the elven forest, the peace of the green landscape, and the harmonious coexistence of elves and animals welled up out of Aaron's deepest memories and filled him with a sense of peace that he had not experienced for a long time. Jelni Nolan had meanwhile walked to the end of one of the piers and seemed to be playing to the entire sea. Suddenly, Ahren caught sight of Selcina's slim, white body swimming towards the harbour on the crest of a rising wave. The alluring music with its memories of the elven lands was still sounding, but now it was Selcina with her billowing mane that Ahren could see in his mind's eye as she ran through Evergreen.
"She's summoning Selcina's old self," said Falk, his voice cracking with emotion.
Ahren laid a reassuring hand on Falk's shoulder, too overcome himself to respond with words. He spotted Kara sitting two carriages further back, seemingly awestruck. A solitary tear was rolling down the young woman's cheek, and Aaron's heart missed a beat. He wanted to run back to her, but just at that moment, the crowd around them roared, and he was distracted. The wave that Selcina was swimming on was heading directly for Jelna Nolan, increasing speed all the time. Had the spell gone wrong? Ahren climbed down from the carriage and was torn between going to Kara or Jelna Nolan when the wave broke furiously over the end of the pier. For a moment it seemed as though the mass of water would overwhelm the still-playing elf, but at the last instant the wave split in two, and Selcina galloped out of the flood. With hooves thundering, wet silver flanks glittering, and loud whinnying, the elven charger galloped past Jelni Nolan, who had stepped nimbly aside, and into the arms of the waiting Falk. The unicorn radiated a powerful wave of joy and satisfaction into the crowd, causing the celebratory atmosphere to ignite. Jelna Nolan finished her melody with a gently fading finale and then walked back to the carriage with the cheers of the onlookers ringing in her ears. Selcina rubbed her head against Falk's breastplate, and he placed his hands around her head in return, their gestures towards each other being so gentle that none of the three horns on Selcina's skull plate injured the old paladin.
"Her speech is still somewhat orotund, but apart from that she seems quite her old self again," said Falk, breathing a sigh of relief.
"The ocean is broad and deep," said Jelna Nolan reassuringly. "She'll need time for her thoughts to emerge from it fully."
Ahren slapped Selcina's flank affectionately, delighted too that proper order had been restored. But had it? The memory of Kara's tear sent a shiver down his spine, and he quickly rounded the Titijunanwa, only to stop dead in his tracks. Kara was sitting completely emotionless in her carriage, watching the reuniting of Falk and Selcina with cold indifference. Whatever impression the enchanting song had made on her, the moment had passed, and Kara's emotions were once again under lock and key. Ahren clenched his fists. All he wanted to do was scream in frustration.
"You've just seen the first chink in her armor," said Cullen, trying to give his friend hope. "Hold on to that thought. A wolf does not complain about the winter, but yearns patiently for the oncoming spring."
Ahren didn't know when Cullen had developed this philosophical streak, and for the moment it interested him not a whit. Outwardly calm but full of frustration within, he followed Jelninolan and Falk back to their carriage. Cullen and Selcina took up their positions to the left and right of the vehicle, and no sooner had Ahren swung up onto his seat than the train began moving again. "Everything all right?" asked Jelninolan, apparently reading Aaron's inner turmoil on his face. The young paladin nodded, forcing himself to remain calm. "Your melody earlier got through to Kara. Unfortunately, its effect was temporary." Much to his surprise, the elf beamed at him. "That is good news, Ahren. The grip of the void seems to be loosening." Ahren nodded slowly before turning his head away from the elf's gaze, which seemed to be reading his very heart. Men, women, and children were lining the street on either side of them, throwing flowers at the carriages as they cheered Ahren and the others on. One would think we had already won a war, and not that the conflict was about to begin, he said darkly.
"This is a good start," said Falk, leaning over the left side of the carriage to pat Selcina's flank affectionately. "From now on, we shall have to fight against despair, which will be our companion on every step of our journey. But today we have won our first battle against that enemy. We are expecting poor peasants and badly equipped militiamen and women to fight with us against the adversary's dark ones. The morale of the simple folk will nourish itself for many a day to come on the happy events of today."
Ahren tried to suppress his own frustration, spotting something that helped him in that regard. "Not only their morale," he said sardonically, nodding behind Jelninolan, "it seems that our musical priestess now has a fervent admirer." The elf looked back in puzzlement. From the royal carriage, King Senius Blueground was making such blatant sheep's eyes at Jelninolan that he looked more like an awkward youth than a seasoned monarch of middle age. Falk's face creased with laughter lines as he bowed respectfully.
"Congratulations on your conquest, dearest Jelninolan. Aldini's joy will be unbridled at the political advantages your impending marital alliance with the king will bring with it."
The elf smiled amicably back at the monarch, but her voice was as cold as ice. "Another word and I will turn you into a whale, and a fat pockmarked one to boot." Falk pursed his lips and tilted his head, as he always did when conversing with Selcina. It seemed he had decided to take Jelninolan's threat seriously, engaging instead in a silent conversation with the retransformed unicorn. Not wishing to spend the rest of his days swimming in the harbour waters either, Ahren concentrated on taking in the city as they negotiated the streets that were still full of cheering people. Just as the last time he had been here, the striking differences between rich and poor were still in evidence. but now there was an added dimension. Whereas before the nobility had boasted their wealth through jewelry and elaborate carriages, now it was the number of guards they had, along with how many weapons the guards carried, which seemed to indicate their status. Some of the properties they passed had dozens of sentries outside, where before Ahren had seen only one or two. It seems that everything on King's Island is connected somehow with status, even war, he said dryly. At least that is an elitist little game that could be useful to us, responded Falk grimly. I am quite sure that Aldini will find a way of incorporating all of these superfluous guards into the army. Finally, they reached the gates of the palace, and Ahren was relieved to see that there were no more curious onlookers in its spacious grounds. He picked the flowers out of his hair and flicked them off his clothing. The floor of the carriage was strewn with blooms that had been thrown at them. Ahren was still shaking his head in disbelief at the whole thing when he noticed a furtive movement in the floor space of the carriage. He uttered a warning cry, causing Falk and Jelna Nolan to stand up in alarm, at which point he unceremoniously pushed the pair out over the low doors of the carriage before tumbling out himself and landing on the cobblestones with a skillful acrobatic roll. Elegantly clothed servants rushed to the assistance of the three companions, but Ahren was already up on his feet. No one is to open this carriage, he shouted at the lackeys. Everyone else get out immediately, he roared. We weren't only being showered with flowers. While Aaron's companions had reacted swiftly by leaping out of their vehicles, the other dignitaries weren't quite so agile. Ahren feverishly tried to use his arm to guide a baroness out of one carriage, but she stared at him in confusion and annoyance until the elderly lady suddenly let out a scream and reached down towards her right leg. Even before she had finished the movement, her body stiffened and foam bubbled from her mouth. Then, jerking wildly, she toppled out of the vehicle and was dead before her body hit the ground. Ahren drew his wind blade in a flowing motion and brought it down on the thing that was just releasing itself from the dead woman's thigh. There was a short hissing sound before Ahren called out, Snakes! There are venomous snakes in the carriages! Immediately the other dignitaries threw themselves out of the vehicles while horsemen rode up with burning torches. If the noblemen and women had been slow in their initial reaction, the royal guards were incredibly swift in their responses. While some immediately shielded the king and his guests, the rest set the carriages alight, causing the vehicles and their deadly loads to burn on the spot before the venomous creatures had a chance to escape. Jelninolan kicked the tiny snake, which Ahren had cut clean through with his sword. A sand adder. As the name suggests, it is not native to these northern climes. It's clear that this was an assault, said Aldini, clearly irritated. The archwizard was floating much higher above the ground than was his wont, and kept looking anxiously around. Considering his friend was wearing open sandals, Ahren could understand his nervousness.
It would be best if we went inside, said King Blueground with a worried look. We will be safe there, and I will be able to welcome you properly, at last, without the constant interruptions of fanfares and cheers.
The guards should search the crowds directly before the palace gates, said Kara to the monarch in a neutral voice. The snakes can only have been thrown into the carriages at the end of the route, once enough flowers had gathered on the carriage floors to give the animals cover.
Senius gave one of the royal guards a signal, following which the man rushed off to implement the swordswoman's suggestion.
Assassinations by means of snakes is a favorite method in the Eternal Empire, Your Majesty, suggested one of the horse guards, eyeing Kara suspiciously. She, for her part, seemed to merely glance back at the armored man. Ahren, however, understood his beloved's body language and was in no doubt
that she was on the point of attacking him.
"Far too crude for quinoa," snorted Aldini, shattering that theory. "I bet they were hired henchmen, paid for by a High Fang or a Doppler."
He paused for a moment.
"Did you have the city searched for servants of the Dark God?"
The king nodded officiously. "Using both the city guards and several charms that Elgin casts on a regular basis. Sleeps in treetops, didn't find any dark ones on the streets or in the houses of King's Island either."
"Could you bring us to the two ancients, Your Majesty?" asked Falk politely. "Then we can kill two birds with one stone by performing the niceties of introductions and getting straight down to business." Senius nodded approvingly, and the train of people began moving again. Having arrived at the entrance hall to the palace, Ahren noticed that a good dozen of the royal guards separated from their group, keeping the rest of the courtiers away from the companions and the king. Only the immediate royal bodyguards and his guests of honour strode to a broad staircase lit by torches and leading down a good 10 paces below ground. The passage down there ended with a wide steel door which had the giveaway sheen of deep steel. Trogodon whistled through his teeth and pointed to an ornate sign in the upper corner of the doorframe.
"That is a clan insignia from Thousand Halls, and a damn old one," he said in wonderment.
"This door was once a gift of the dwarves to this royal house," said Senius, in a formal voice.
"Together with a tower within which the Council of War would meet during the Dark Days," interjected Aldini dryly. "The tower was destroyed by a spell during an attack. The door was the only part that survived."
Senius cleared his throat nervously.
"Which is why this conclave is taking place underground. The door should provide better protection here than in the dizzy heights above."
One after another, they stepped into the chamber, which was dimly lit by candles on tall holders. In the middle was an enormous round table, with enough room for at least 2 dozen people to sit around it. It had space for goblets and plates towards its outer rim, but for the most part, the surface of the table was decorated by an incredibly detailed map of Jorath, engraved into its sand-coloured wood.
"Well, that is certainly new," said Aldini, clearly delighted. "At last someone has had a good idea."
"Glad that you like it,"
said a familiar voice from a dark corner of the room. Before Ahren had a chance to identify to whom the voice belonged, a robed figure stepped into the light, arms spread out in welcome.
"Arkad, you're here already!" exclaimed Aldini joyfully,
embracing the popular wizard as hard as his little body would permit. Ahren too moved towards the gregarious character, but he was beaten to it by his friends. Trogodon greeted the man like a long-lost brother, followed by Falk and Jelmin Nolan. Only Kara stood to the side, disinterested, staring instead at the map on the table. Then it was Aaron's turn, and he greeted the wizard with genuine warmth.
"It's great to see you again, sir," said Ahren amicably.
"Oh, come, let's drop the formal address," responded Arkad with a laugh. "If we are going to save the world together, then we should do it as friends, don't you think?"
Ahren grinned. The wizard, who specialized in the creation and sculpting of objects, was such a warm-hearted person that Ahren couldn't help but relax in his presence.
"Could we have some more light?"
Trogodon asked the guard standing by the door.
"The half-light does create a lovely mysterious mood, all right, but it could prove impractical in the long run."
"Forgive us,"
said a dark old voice from the gloom. Ahren squinted and looked in the direction of the speaker, but was only able to make out a small, gaunt shape.
"This circumstance is down to our deficiency. Tartak and I only tolerate the gentlest kiss of the light."
The strange woman gestured to a tall figure
leaning against the far wall of the room, who now began to move hesitantly forward with the speaker. Ahren tried to put on a friendly face, but his eyes must surely have spoken volumes as he began to take in more details of the two strangers. The woman laughed angrily.
"Expectations blind us to the truth, my young paladin," she said mysteriously.
Ahren was looking down at a small, wizened old woman who was completely decorated in tattoos. Her dark skin, the same colour as Aldini's, was hardly visible beneath all the ink. Narrow bones pierced her outer ears, and if her dull eyes had possessed colour many moons previously, now they were covered in a film of white. Her head was shaven bare but for a thick, heavy plait in the middle of her cranium, which hung right down to the ground. It was greyish-white and densely adorned with all sorts of decorations which Ahren identified as gemstones, bones, and engraved leather ribbons.
"Too young to see more than the bark of a tree," mocked the old woman, nodding towards Ahren, before approaching Aldini and Jelninolan. "Do forgive sleeps in treetops," said the tall figure, who now revealed himself to be an elf. "She likes few people, preferring instead the sound of her own voice."
Ahren gave a slight bow, but the elf presented his hand in the human manner, which Ahren grasped in surprise. He looked at his opposite number in greater detail. The elf had silver hair, and his eyes glimmered a deep yellow, almost like liquid gold or the light of two little suns. The stranger's face was attractive and smooth, if a little pale, and there was something strange about this well-toned man. Ahren's eyes quickly scanned down the blackened leather armor, coming to a halt at the elf's two curved daggers. Then he looked back up and saw that the elf was grinning wildly. When he saw the sharpened teeth, it hit him. "You are a wrath elf!" he exclaimed, instinctively letting go of the man's hand. Ahren's impulsive reaction seemed to amuse the stranger, who laughed. It was a loud, unfettered laugh that seemed devoid of any reticence.
"And I am proud to be one of the free elves," he said loudly. "Tartak is my chosen name, and I am here as a friend."
At that he touched his daggers ritualistically with his fingertips before spreading out his hands demonstratively. Ahren stood there frozen to the spot, trying to digest the shock of facing a real, live, wrath elf. In common parlance, they were also known as dark elves, bleak elves, or even blood elves, and the stories concerning their gruesome deeds were hair-raising. Even though Ahren was aware of the true nature of these people, namely that they had originally been elves who had given free rein to their feelings, instead of sacrificing themselves to the common good and harmony of their society, he still had to overcome a multitude of prejudices from his childhood so that he could respond to the man with appropriate politeness. "Forgive my reaction, Tartak. I come from Hjalgar, and your people enjoy a certain reputation there. I am well aware of the fact that my homeland has been protected from dark ones for so long on account of the self-sacrifice of your people." He held out his hand. "And for that, I thank you." Tartak grasped his hand. This time it was a firm handshake between two warriors.
"A paladin and a forest guardian thanks my people for their service. No one in the Shadow Grove will believe this when they hear it," said the wrath elf in amazement.
"A simple no would have been perfectly sufficient," shouted Aldini angrily behind them. He had been deep in conversation with Sleeps in Treetop. "Why do you always have to make things so complicated?" The little arch-wizard floated away from the old woman and lowered himself onto one of the wide chairs at the large round table. The sorceress cackled angrily and sat down too.
Young spirit in a young body, unburdened by time or its sister, wisdom, she blustered, looking at Aldini, who could only gasp in response.
The archwizard and the old woman were clearly getting on just as badly as Ahren had feared they would. His friend, in the figure of a boy, had criticized the peculiarities of the ancient from the northern jungles on more than one occasion, but now it was clear to Ahren that what he was observing was not the usual carping so beloved of Aldini. This was genuine antipathy of the highest order.
"Well, this is a good start," grumbled Trogodon, coming up behind Ahren and looking up at Tartak. "What sort of an elf are you?"
he asked, puzzled. Tartak, for his part, looked down at Trogodon.
"Dwarves, difficult to kill, even more difficult to persuade."
It sounded as though he were quoting from a handbook. The squat warrior grinned broadly.
"Exactly right. I am Trogodon."
"Tartak," said the tall warrior, offering his hand. "I am a free elf." The shark grin reappeared on the elf's face, and Trogodon raised his eyebrows quizzically.
"That must have been painful," he said, pointing, completely unfazed, at the teeth. "Have you ever thought of adding alloy so that they don't break at the wrong moment?"
Ahren held his breath, unsure as to how the strange elf would react to such humor. But the tall warrior slapped the small one on the shoulder and gestured to him to come with him.
"Back there you will find wine and beer. We can discuss it over a strong drink."
Ahren let out a sigh of relief and went over to Falk, who was rubbing his forehead.
"Ye gods, I had forgotten that attending these conclaves was like walking on eggshells," muttered the old paladin. "It was bad enough in the dark days, but some of the peoples who will gather here in the room haven't spoken to each other in centuries."
"Are all the allies going to turn up?" asked Ahren in amazement. "I thought Aldini's summons was too spur of the moment for everyone to arrive on time."
Falk shrugged his shoulders. "So far, the Wrath Elves and the Elves from Ithinian have arrived, but they are keeping out of each other's way for the moment and have not been in the same room together. Of the Ancients, Akkad, Elgin, Aldini, Jelninolan, and Sleeps in Treetop are here. There are three of us paladins thus far, but Aluna is still to arrive, and Bergen is sure to come with Justinian shortly, at least. That's what he said he would do. We don't know if Sunju is coming."
Falk was using his fingers to count up the names.
"Kelkor wishes to send an emissary, as does the Silver Cliff. No word from Thousand Halls, but that is hardly a surprise. Until we present the 13th to them, they will continue to hide in the mountains and bide their time. The clans from the Green Sea have not responded. Their prairies are remarkably quiet. And if Kinwar turns up, I'll eat my saddle."
Ahren gasped in astonishment. "And have none of the other paladins responded to Aldini's call?" Falk shook his head glumly.
"Alas, no, my boy. It seems we shall have to continue our search for them as soon as this conclave has ended."
Ahren looked around the room and considered the situation. Akkad, Tartak, Fisker, and Trogodon were standing around a small beer barrel and seemed to have plumped for the pleasant part of the Council of War rather than the diplomatic intricacies, while Uldini sat with Senius Blueground, pointing urgently again and again at various parts of the table map. Jelninolan was standing beside Kara, talking to the young woman while glancing suspiciously from time to time at the Wrath Elf. Cullen and Kosobo were involved in a staring duel, one of the few games between the two soul animals that the wolf occasionally won, which at least made for some excitement between the pair of them, as the outcome was always in doubt. Sleeps in Treetop was simply gazing vacantly into the room, a mysterious smile on her lips.
It was already clear that the participants were dividing up into little cliques, even though half of the participants still had not arrived. Ahren pursed his lips and wondered what the oncoming days and weeks would bring with them.
"I have bad news for you all," said King Blueground, beginning his report once a formal welcoming ceremony had been completed.
He had ordered everyone to sit down so that he could bring those present up to date with the latest state of affairs.
"Somehow the adversary has managed to rip a gaping hole in the defensive ring with which we had hoped to cut off the borderlands from the eastern territories."
The monarch pointed at the black spot in the middle of the map.
"The night marshes were to secure the northeast, the sunplains the southeast. An alliance of the two lands, together with scouts and giants from Kelkor, were to secure the east, and therefore Hjalgar."
He pointed at the little country lying directly beside the borderlands and surrounded by its powerful neighbors. The king picked up some stylized figures and placed them in the exact positions on the map that he had just referred to, thereby illustrating the current positions of the armies.
"The Ithinian has declared itself ready to hold the northwest until the Green Sea has fully prepared its defences, but we still have heard nothing from the clans. What Kinwa is up to in the west and southwest is a mystery to us, but we are sure that she will secure her borders if she has not long since done so."
More figures were positioned on the map.
"The Forest of Ire is blocking the enemy in the south, which should theoretically have closed the circle."
The king placed the last figure in position, and the borderlands were completely surrounded and isolated from the populated areas about it.
"Such was our plan," said the king. "Then this happened."
He removed one of the horsemen which had been standing in the east on the middle of Hjalgar's western border, and suddenly they were all staring at the gap in the defensive circle.
"Unfortunately, one of our largest volunteer armies, the militiamen of the Three, has been wiped out overnight by the enemy. They never had the chance to take position and hold the border until the other combat units were in situ."
The monarch took the two figures on either side of the gap and placed them in the middle of Hjalgar.
"Dark ones are streaming through the hole and flooding Hjalgar. The reports are chaotic, but officers seem to be the primary targets during the skirmishes, for the moment. The attacks are coordinated and precise."
Falk's cursing was the only thing to be heard in the ensuing silence, but Ahren could only quietly agree with the old man.
"Can we not divert troops from the north and south to patch up the gap?" asked Ahren after some time.
The king spread out his hands.
"That's what we are here to discuss, at least when everyone has arrived. But there is more."
"More?" groaned Aldini, wearily rubbing his eyes.
Senius nodded glumly. "We are certain that the attacks in Hjalgar are being supported by a new breed of Dark Ones. Our spies suggest that they are low fangs of extraordinary strength, who use long-range weapons. But no one has survived their attacks thus far."
"Impossible!" exclaimed Falk. "Lofangs have never used such weapons before. Half of them don't even possess the necessary hands or eyes in the right place."
"The wounds on the fallen soldiers and villagers leave no room for doubt," said the king firmly.
Then he placed over a dozen little discs in locations within Hjalgar.
"These are all burned-out villages, settlements, and towns. We can be sure that Hjalgar is now in a state of total chaos."
Aaron's eyes welled up with tears. The black points represented dead people, hundreds, perhaps thousands, maybe even tens of thousands. And every day the number was growing. He looked at Senius in horror, and the king nodded sympathetically.
I still haven't finished, unfortunately.
Jelna Nolan covered her mouth with her hands, while Sleeps in Treetop cast a little spell onto the middle of the table. A swirling black cloud appeared over the borderlands, covering a good third of the godforsaken area.
That is the Pall Pillar, as I saw it a moon ago, said the small woman, her dark old voice cutting the air. Like a voracious monster, it swallows up every innocent abroad before spewing them out again as new, true servants of the dark god.
A heavy silence descended on the council chamber. Ahren looked at the king questioningly, expecting yet more bad news, but the monarch slumped back in his chair.
That is everything, said the king in a haunted voice.
Ahren looked down at the chaos on the war map, recognizing bitterly that they had more than enough problems to have justified the conclave. Chapter 3 Ahren sat in his chair dumbstruck and stared at the heavy swirling mass of smoke symbolizing the bubbling voracious monster into which the adversary had transformed the Pall Pillar. All around him were cries of consternation and gasps as everyone tried to come to terms with the shock of the dreadful news. He glanced over at Kara, who, unlike the others, remained calm and unruffled. And all of a sudden he envied her imperturbability, which protected her from the storm of emotions seething within the council chamber. Fear, rage, frustration, powerlessness, and uncertainty hung like demons in the air, seeming to gouge their claws deep into the spirits of the attendees, who were calling out amongst each other, searching desperately for ideas and solutions. If an ire wind had blown into this room, it would have changed direction and fled in an instant. Ahren admired the king for his foresight in discussing the matter with a small circle of advisers first. The young forest guardian couldn't imagine how things might have developed had the wild Kelkor clans and the Sun Emperor been in the room too.
Do something, Ahren, urged Cullen in his thoughts.
We should take a break, he murmured amidst the noisy confusion. Aldini had been trying to glean more information concerning the Pall Cloud from Sleeps in Treetop, but her cryptic responses only enraged him even more, and at this point he was screaming. Tartak, meanwhile, was hammering home the point that the Forest of Ire urgently needed reinforcements before the cloud would enshroud the land of the Wrath Elves, while Falk was demanding at the top of his voice that the king inform him precisely what the state of his military strength was. Trogodon, Fisker, and Akkad were broaching the second beer barrel. The three of them were standing there with empty yet stoic looks on their faces.
Ahren,
warned the wolf again, pressing his head against his friend's shoulder.
Get to it.
We should take a break,
roared Ahren at the top of his voice, causing everyone to turn and look at him.
Each of us needs a little time to digest what we have heard. Nothing constructive can be achieved today by continuing to sit around this table.
The whelp speaks the words of the old, chattered Sleeps in Treetop angrily. Those without eyes or understanding should listen to what he says. Now you listen to me, you little old, said Aldini, but already Falk was standing up from his chair.
Ahren is right. I, for my part, need a bottle of wine and some sleep, then another bottle of wine, a bath, and some more sleep. After that we can continue the discussion.
The old paladin nodded to the others and walked purposefully towards the door, determined to put his plan into effect. Ahren stood up and followed his example. The remaining members of the Council of War rose from their chairs with hardly a word being exchanged, and the chamber slowly emptied. The room where, over the following days and weeks, the fate of a little country that Ahren had considered his homeland for so many years would be decided.
"So many deaths," whispered Ahren.
The wind was whipping against his face, a taste of the oncoming autumn which promised to be wet and raw here on the coast. Ahren had fled to the northwest tower of the palace so that he could be alone with his thoughts and with Cullen. The wolf pressed his muzzle against Aaron's head without saying a word. The fact that the normally so communicative and self-confident animal had no useful nuggets of advice for him suggested that the young man was not the only one who felt the hopelessness of the situation in Hjalgar. He punched his fist against the stone parapet, the resultant pain providing welcome relief to his tortured mind. How he missed talking to Kara. Under normal circumstances, she would be up here with him now, conversing with him and giving him courage, instead of which she had given him no thought whatsoever, but had left the meeting to go in search of her lodgings. Glumly, Ahren stared out beyond the city to the sea, which followed its never-ending cycle of ebbing and flowing, oblivious to the cares of humanity, while the rays of sunlight kissed its surface.
So this is where you are hiding.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.